Hello, everyone, and welcome to True Crime. I'm Greg, host and curator of True Crime. Each week, I find a True Crime episode from a different independent podcast creator. If you love the episode, look in the show notes for links to subscribe to their podcast. If you enjoy True Crime and appreciate the work I do highlighting independent artists, please consider buying me a coffee at buymeacoffee.com/indiedroppin or consider leaving True Crime a positive review on your favorite podcast app. Good reviews help people decide to give this show a try. All right, let's get to it. Today's episode is from A Nefarious Nightmare. A Nefarious Nightmare covers true crime or spooky macabre stories with humor and compassion for victims. Enjoy the show.
Begin.
Content warning. This episode includes foul language and discussions of violence. Trigger warning. This episode includes discussions of murder, torture, mentions of sexual abuse, mental illness, and suicidal ideation. Listener discretion is strongly advised. Amanda, what do you think about the game of broken telephone?
I think that it's a horrible way to get information, and it could have some pretty bad consequences.
Yep.
It could be fun in the right setting and context, you know, as an actual game.
Mm-hmm.
But when it goes real life, that's where things tend to get a little murky.
So, do you know of a time where you were in a position where people gossiped about you or told lies about you?
Of course. All of us have fallen victim to that.
Do you know how lucky you are to be alive then?
I guess I never really thought about it.
I mean, me neither really, but this episode kind of will brush up on bullying and gossip. And it's going to have more of a serious tone to it. You know, broken telephone isn't necessarily quite what happened here. I mean, it's pretty close, but if it's not played like the actual children's game, it can be a form of gossip.
Oh, well. Okay. Also, it's sad that bullying is seemingly gaming more traction now that social media and the internet are involved.
Yep. And unfortunately, no matter how much it has, you know, a light shed on it, it still occurs and seems to get worse every single day. And I don't know about you. Actually, I'm pretty sure you're the same way, but I pretty much have a soft spot for those that are being bullied. Mm-hmm. And I always have because I myself was bullied. I think at one point all of us were, and some people dealt with it to worse degrees.
One thing I want to say to everybody listening, if you're being bullied, just remember that the person doing that to you is fighting their own inner battle. And he's, or she,
yeah,
is probably being bullied even worse and taking it out on you. It doesn't excuse the behavior, but it's often mirroring what's happening to them at home. If you're being threatened or bullied in any way, please reach out and speak to someone. If you have a friend, tell your friend. If you have a good family, talk to them. Tell them.
Yeah.
Hell, our inbox is open.
Yeah.
And while we may not respond right away, we can at least be an ear or a shoulder.
Yes, absolutely agree. And if for whatever reason you do not have an inner circle, there are resources available out there to help you out. We will brush up on bullying and broken telephone in the future, but for whatever reason, this case that I'm covering today really drives both of those things deep into the ground for me, and I'm wanting to address it because in a lot of ways, those two things ended in a super senseless death. This case is very little known, and it deserves to have a huge light shed on it. And, you know, we're going to link this, you know, in the show notes, but, you know, you can find plenty of resources, including the Trevor Project, at bullybust.org/resources.
I'm glad we're covering this case because it's not very well known. And for what?
It's interesting and infuriating. Not a single podcast has covered this case. If I'm wrong, call me out on it. But I've found no evidence that this has been covered outside of just New Philadelphia, Ohio. And no, this isn't a case about your typical big-time serial killer or a viral missing persons case, but every victim's story deserves to be heard, and Justin Barnard is absolutely no exception.
So, thank you to Sonya, Coen, for suggesting this case, and thank you, Courtney, for deep diving into what we have named this episode, A Taboo Tango.
So Amanda, when I saw his picture in his obituary, my eyes kind of welled up. You can definitely tell that he had this genuine soul, like he had this naivety about him. He looked to be very smart, but also very giving, like he could have easily been taken advantage of. And I wrote this paragraph prior to learning more about the murder, so it will be interesting if I'm right to say that he might have been bullied. He seems like the kind of kid that would show up on your doorstep if you needed help with something, and no matter how much work he had given him, he would just smile right through it. Kind of like a yes man. And what makes this sad is that this world is completely trying to diminish that kind of personality, and then there's sick people out there that will fully take advantage of that right down to their death. And truth be told, we need more yes men like Justin Barnard, but unfortunately, it's becoming extinct.
I can already tell this is going to be heartbreaking.
Yeah, get you a whole box of fucking Kleenex if you can. Because I'm already, like, welling up just reading my notes a little bit. So, Justin was born in Canton, Ohio, to Patricia Barnard Stoller and Michael Barnard, who is actually from Felton, California. According to some sources, it's said that he wasn't well cared for in his childhood, but I cannot confirm that as fact because so many different sources suggest otherwise, and based off of my own reading, I only see parents that really absolutely wanted justice for their son. However, it is thought that he had grown up with very little and basically had a life suggesting financial difficulty, which is, it's hard for anybody going through that. The majority of his academic life was spent within the New Philadelphia School District, but also spent over a year living with his dad in California. During his brief time in Cali, he was described as someone who had a passion for helping his friends, spoiling his pets, an animal lover, telling outrageous stories. So, you know, I'm imagining someone with an adventurer and fantasy type of spirit, much like my husband. And he loved using Lego, as well as model cars and model aircraft to create things for others that would reveal his vivid imagination. He had also loved NASCAR, where his brother... Awesome. Where his brother is certain that Justin's ability to take things apart and put them back together would make him a great candidate for a mechanic in just about any pit crew.
Ugh, I'm already furious, because he had his entire life ahead of him, and I'm guessing it was completely robbed from him.
Yep. So what we are doing is making sure that he is known about and remembered. He enjoyed bike riding, skateboarding, and was into playing video games and watching television.
So basically your typical kid.
Yes, absolutely. He was noted also as being really into The Daily Show.
Aww, that's just too cute.
Yeah. Justin was considered as a caregiver to his friends and family, and many friends remember Justin, quote, for his attentive ear and for his his ability to listen. He was thought of as a teenage therapist.
And why did this happen to him?
You know, there's not a single good reason, as you will find out. This case is heartbreaking. His mom remembers him as someone who was, like most teenagers, trying to find himself, who never even had a driver's license or never fell deeply in love and had his heart broken, that someone had stopped him too short. He always gravitated towards the troubled kids or outcasts because he got along with the misfits more than anyone else.
Sounds like he would have loved our inner circle.
Oh, yes. Yes, he would have.
I would have welcomed him with open arms.
Me too. And normally, when remembering a victim, we would pull a comment or two from the obituary, but there are so many comments. So instead, we've gathered a ton of information from close sources and link his obituary in the show notes under sources, which I do strongly encourage everyone to go read because the comments are truly something.
Oh, well, yeah, I will.
Okay. So there was a teen center he used to visit called Park Place Teen Center. This is where he had become friends with my two sources, Sonya Coen, who had worked there, and Christina Daniels, both who have helped me paint a better portrait of Justin Barnard.
Was Park Place Teen Center like a rec center?
I mean, I thought so at first, but what it looked like was just like a hangout spot, and it looked like a billiards bar, but teenagers were allowed and encouraged to hang out. I know they had something like that in Mesquite, Texas. I can't remember the name, but I went once or twice with friends. And a lot of the information that's on him moving forward will come from those sources. And I do want to say ahead of time that they both are relying on memory and that they're giving me everything that they can remember. I also want to thank both Christina and Sonya for participating in this with me in an effort to keep Justin's memory alive.
Yes, thank you both.
All right, so Sonya recalls, quote, Justin was the most kind kid and he loved Legos. So I met him while I was working at our local teen center. Most of the teens, like most, came there and would hang out and visit with friends, as expected. Justin was always helping out around the teen center and helping the other kids when they needed computer, game, or pool access if he could help. He had this innocence and naivety about him. Nearly every Halloween, he would pass out candy for the trick-or-treaters at the center. He was seriously, hands down, one of the kindest people I've ever met.
It seems like a lot of people, from what I've read, are saying that or similar.
Yes, and another source, who does wish to remain anonymous, she says, he didn't come from much. I don't think, but I can't say for certain, but I don't believe his home life was the best. He didn't ever go to Park Place with money, but he did always go. He's the type of guy that if only had a quarter to his name and he needed it, he'd give it to you.
Oh, wow. What a good kid.
Yeah. And upon discussing this further with both Sonya and Christina, they both had some vague memories about Amanda Bowditch, who plays a big part in this. And for the sake of accuracy and to better explain the situation and to give our listeners a better idea of how Amanda...
Not me, guys. Just putting that out there. My last name's Cronin and I'm a Texas...
Yeah, no, not our Mandy Pandy, but how Amanda Bowditch ties into Justin. I will say that, you know, these are just memories and some of these are uncertain and that some of the things remembered were from what others had said. Both Christina and Sonya would like to go on record to say that they aren't entirely sure, but that this is what they remember.
So for the sake of avoiding broken telephone, we go on record saying that we are relying on facts and also just stating that these are things that were remembered and some of those things can't be hard fact.
So Amanda grew up, like Justin, having very little. It's also believed but uncertain that some sexual abuse and trauma had occurred in her childhood, which brought about a personality later described as cold and abrasive, possibly as a defense mechanism that was nurtured due to the possibility of abuse. She's remembered in later adolescence as someone who was mentally unstable, who would often play a victim of situations she would instigate in the first place, and bend to whatever was going on around her for the sake of getting people to like her. So she was both impressionable and hard.
Would this be typical of borderline personality disorder?
Yeah.
I'm not a therapist, but that's kind of what it sounds like.
Well, you're actually right on the nose. You'll find that out too. Also, she had a manipulative personality and would obtain what she believed to be close friendships, whom these friends did not actually reciprocate once she was not present. So basically, like, unfortunately, yeah, they would kind of talk some smack about her behind her back. But she's also remembered as someone who didn't take her personal hygiene very seriously, which could both be a response to depression or another trauma response. She was the recipient of some bullying due to that.
Sounds like she could use our sign-off as advice. You know, don't be a Richard and wear antiperspirant.
You know, holy shit, I didn't even put that together, but you're absolutely right. I mean, I have the tiniest amount of sympathy for her, as you will see, but still, no excuse. Don't be a dick, you know, wear that fucking deodorant and maybe take a shower.
Exactly.
Yeah. So at one point, Amanda and her husband, Chad Bowditch, had separated and a brief relationship occurred between Justin and Amanda. Once the separation between Chad and Amanda was reconciled, Justin and Amanda parted ways. Now remember, Chad is known for extreme anger and jealousy.
It also doesn't help that the name Chad mm-hmm. has been known to be the male equivalent to the name Karen.
Nope, it does not help at all. Does not help in his case at all. And personally, all but one Chad I've ever met have been utter douche canoes. And I'm not saying that all Chads equate to bad. Personally, I think it's just a coincidence, but it's still kind of weird.
I don't like that my name is being shared in this case either, by the way.
Well, well, as you will soon see, there are two Justins in this case. One good and one not so good. So really, names are just names. Not all Justins are good, not all Amandas are bad, and not all Chads and Karens are douche canoes.
The vision of a douche canoe is weird in my head. A canoe with a nozzle. Kind of interesting.
Yeah, and it's very relevant to this case. No, I'm kidding. but douche canoes are interesting, folks. So the discovery. On September 27th, 2005, at the Tuscarawas River, located near Akron, Ohio, and Barberton, Ohio. Guys, I'm sorry, I'm getting my tongue tied a little bit here. I've already had to edit this out once, so we're going to try not to do that again. But police discovered a body wrapped in a sheet that was bound in blue weighted rope, snagged on a tree limb. A further discovery revealed a bloated and badly decomposing body and later confirmed it to be that of Justin Barnard. And we will later circle back right back to this very paragraph.
Oh, no.
Yeah. So it all started on the previous Sunday, September 18th, 2005, where Justin visited Tuscora Park, which is located in New Philadelphia. He went to meet with some friends, and according to sources, he stayed the night at a brown house near the home of a 42-year-old woman by the name of Diane Dinkelman, who will come up later.
A 42-year-old woman in this case sounds sus.
Yes. According to Justin's mother, she, not Diane, but Justin's mother had seen Chad and Amanda Bowditch often, and Justin had planned to move in with them. So Justin's mother knew of Chad and Amanda. It's pretty unclear as to how well, but given the statements made later, she knew that Justin at least cared about one of them.
And it's so interesting how this town seemed like everyone knew about everyone.
Yeah, I was talking to Sonya about this, and she was telling me that rumors were a dime a dozen there.
I'm sure.
Yeah.
So definitely small town mentality. I just wanted to help paint a picture.
And that's really funny that you should say that, because we had a group chat about this and we ended up naming the chat Painting Justin, because I'm honestly wanting to give a good portrait of Justin Barnard and his life for our listeners. So yeah, Painting Justin. That really should be the title of this episode, but you know, alphabetical order and whatnot.
We're almost done.
So Chad and Amanda Bowditch were due to be evicted from the home, and they were already in the middle of moving their stuff to Diane Dinkelman's home, where Justin Stefan lived. Now, for the sake of clarity, and since there are two Justins in this case, I will refer to Justin Stefan as just Stefan moving forward.
All right. So I also want to cut in here and just let everyone know that there was yet another Justin.
Mm-hmm.
His name was also Justin Barnard, and he had been murdered over in Oklahoma due to an apparent hit put out by him by his girlfriend.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I was kind of reading through that case a little bit, thinking that it was the case you were going to be doing. It's so odd how both of these cases are pretty similar.
Right? Names! I'm telling you, it's a coincidence. Or is it? Then, Monday, September 19th, Diane Dinkelman took the Bowditches and Stefan, to work at the Trail of Terror, which was a Halloween-themed attraction located close by.
Is it safe to say that Dinkelman was a little bit of a pedophile?
I mean, I wouldn't want to assume that, but I do see why you would think that, because it is a little bit odd that Dinkelman is hanging around with these high school kids. Granted, they were of age, but even still, it's a little bit weird.
True. I've heard of just plainly good-hearted older people kind of taking younger people in and out of just pure goodness of their hearts.
Yeah.
But honestly, I can already tell that Dinkelman is not a good person.
Right you are. So that evening, Dinkelman went to pick them up. Justin Barnard was with his friends at the Tuscarawas County. Tuscarawas is a very difficult word to say. You guys, I'm very sorry, but I'm trying. But it's a tongue twister. That word is a tongue twister in itself. And
I don't want to say it.
Yeah, just to go off the script. Sonya was like, yeah, you should like not tell Amanda how to pronounce that and see what she does. And I'm the one having the problem.
No, I would just stop and stare at it if you put that in front of me.
Well, they were also saying that we can call it like T County. I think it was T County. But I'm just going to wing it and just call it Tuscarawas County Fair. And do what?
You're doing good.
I'm doing my best. So, Justin Barnard was with his friends at the Tuscarawas County Fair at this time, minding his own fucking business, mind you. The Bowditches and Stefan went to the store to pick up snacks and alcohol, I guess getting ready to party after a long day at a Halloween theme park. They get back to Dinkelman's house and decide to plot the murder.
Meanwhile, Justin is at the fair, minding his own business, unaware of what's to come and happen.
Yep. Just minding his own business, dude. In fact, you know, Justin's probably having the time of his life right here. He just turned 18. This is 2005, right around the time that MySpace had become a huge thing. Personally, 2005 was a huge year in a lot of ways and for a lot of people. Imagine being freshly 18 in that year. Shit, I was 23 that year. And it was a fun year and very carefree and also scary as fuck. It was fun because I had discovered the beauty of MySpace. I was really trying to push my music and my social networking skills to the limit. Met a lot of really cool people. It was also the year that I experienced the most heartbreaking breakup. And also found out about 2 months later that a former friend of mine was found to have murdered his mother and was already wanted on child pornography charges. Which, yeah. Imagine my shock seeing that dude's face plastered all over the news. And I had zero idea that he would be even capable of something like that.
That is insane.
It's fucking crazy, right?
We're going to get back to that. But
yeah, we will. We will, but...
It does go to show you that sometimes you really don't know someone.
Right.
I was in my sophomore year of high school in 2005.
Yeah.
Well, in September of 2005, I was a sophomore.
Yeah.
And I didn't really have too many cares in the world. I just went to school, worked every day after school, chatting on AOL chat rooms.
AOL.
By MySpace over and over again with different music.
HTML. We learned HTML.
Yes, ASL. But when I wasn't doing that, it was, of course, I was with my boyfriend. My God.
And, you know, AIM. My username was Dragons and Angels. I was so hardcore. It was Dragons and Angels was mine, and then at some point was also, don't laugh at me, Juggalette Strawberry. But anyways, 2005. It was the year of Hurricane Katrina. Hong Kong's Disneyland opened, YouTube and Reddit launched.
Oh.
Yeah, Starbucks opened its 10,000th coffee house. The most popular search terms on ask.com included President Bush, Usher, Lindsay Lohan pregnancy, Star Wars, and NHL. And aside from MySpace, here's some more fun pop culture things that happened in 2005. You ready?
Yes.
Okay, American Idol was the number one watched TV show. Guitar Hero was announced. We Belong Together by Mariah Carey was among the top songs, as was Holla Back Girl by Gwen Stefani. Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire was big. Destiny's Child announced their disbandment. Clint Eastwood won the Oscar for Best Picture and Best Director for Million Dollar Baby.
Oh, speaking of Clint Eastwood?
Yeah.
Everyone just go Google Scott Eastwood.
Oh. Okay, I'll do that.
Go ahead.
Brad Pitt and Jennifer Aniston's divorce was everyone's business for some reason. Michael Jackson was arrested for 10 felonies and 4 misdemeanor charges of child molestation, but was found not guilty after a 14-week trial, and all charges were removed. No comment. Xbox 360 and PlayStation were popular. So was Nintendogs. And what the fuck was that? Nintendogs?
No.
I mean, all I'm thinking of is like a Nintendo controller that's shaped like a hot dog. Amanda, you're going to love this. The Office premiered and got incredibly low ratings.
Yes, they did. I know. But little did they know, a fantastic show was just getting started.
I need to try to get into that show. It's taken me about 15 years. Prince Harry from England was reported to be seen at a costume party dressed as a Nazi.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Harry?
Yeah, Prince Harry.
Oh, man. So many costumes from back then did not age well, did they?
No, a Nazi costume will never, ever age well unless you're portraying one in a movie.
Not for funsies, though. Appropriation of cultures.
Like indigenous people?
Yes. Or yeah. Anything like that. It's not a good idea either when it comes to costumes. And also, nothing about Nazis are fun.
I did not see that coming. Get it? Nazi? Nazi?
Wow. You found a way to add a dad joke to this one.
That one's for you, Sonya. Much respect and be thankful for that dad joke.
I'm just... Wow. You never cease to amaze me with that brain of yours, you weirdo.
According to one of my sources, the Blogspot Wikisource, they call Dinkelman D and say that she's easily upset. So Chad decides to tell Dinkelman that Justin Barnard is running around the neighborhood basically talking shit about her and that he needs to be silenced for good.
So this is the bullying and broken telephone you opened up with?
Yeah, and It didn't end well at all. They all leave to go look for Justin, but they cannot find him because he's at the fair minding his own fucking business. My apologies. I'm already pissed.
Also, it's okay to want the D, but I assure you all that you do not want this D that Courtney is talking about.
I see your dad joke, and I raise you with the fact that if you have a penis, maybe don't name it Dinkleman, because all I can imagine is a shrinky dink, and the fact that man is at the end of that, like, all I can think of is the song Don't Want No Short Dick Man by the 90s dance group Gillette that played...
That played over and over
on Kiss FM, and also the censored Short Man played all the time at the skating rink for whatever reason.
Well, I see your dad joke rebuttal.
Uh-huh.
And raised you with the fact that we are starting to sway off topic.
Uh-huh.
Do you remember Ritalin?
Uh-huh.
Do they still treat ADHD with that? Because, wow, Courtney.
No, but I got my Ritalin. Get it? Riddle.
Good one. I like it.
That was like a whole, like, slew of dad jokes right there.
Boom, ba boom, boom.
Ba-dum-tis. So, Justin and one of his friends arrive at the brown house near midnight, and Chad and Stefan shows up. They invite Justin over to their place, saying that they are planning a surprise party for Dinkleman. Justin obliges and follows into the house. He was given a beer. Stefan had taken a bit of acid, and all of them were smoking pot.
Sounds like a stellar 2005 party, but I'm guessing that it goes south from here.
Technically, it stays in Ohio, actually, but you're not wrong. At this point, Chad and Stefan tell Justin that they are heading down to the basement. So that it actually technically did go south. Sorry, they went down to the basement, down south, to get some more beer. It didn't take much convincing to get Justin to follow them because they were partying and having a hell of a time. They all make it to the basement where Dee was hiding and waiting. You know, because at a surprise birthday party, as the birthday gal, as the person being surprised, you're supposed to wait and hide. Isn't that how that works?
I do that all the time for my surprise parties.
Oh, fine.
Jump out and surprise myself. I don't like surprises. That's not my that type of person. And if you surprise me, I have zero reaction.
Okay.
Like, my husband can buy me a new car, and I'm like, oh, wow, thanks. Like, that's the most reactions you like that he gets out of me, and it drives him insane.
Yeah.
Like, he will try to up himself just to get a reaction out of me.
Mm-hmm.
Even though I gave him, like, the biggest reaction the other day because he said he would take me out for fondue. That I got excited about.
Sounds good, actually.
Who did I get excited about? So, he threw me a surprise party for my 30th birthday.
Oh.
And, of course, I thought he was. I didn't know for a fact, but I thought he was. And so, like, he took me out to dinner. My cousin stayed with the kids. And then, you know, my cousin decorated the house and everything with the help of my husband's best friend. And we get back and he opens the door and I like push him in the door first. He was trying to get me to walk in the door first and I pushed him into the door first.
That's hilarious.
I just had this feeling like I knew.
That's
and nice. Then, yeah, he was so mad at me that night.
You totally threw him under the bus, dude.
Oh, he's like, did you know? I was like, yeah, kind of.
And I can understand his frustration, honestly, because Nate does the same shit. I'll, like, try to get him something that I think he really, really wants or do something really nice for him. And he's just like, oh, that's cool. And I'm just like, thanks. Anyway.
Yeah, my mama said that I've been like this since I was little. So it's just me.
Okay, well, we still love you, but you're frustrating. And, you know, I can relate about, like, the surprise thing, like not liking it, even though I've never had a surprise party. So Chad and Stefan, beers in hand, they corner Justin, which Justin was oblivious because this is somewhat normal behavior when you're inebriated at a party.
Yeah. When you're under the influence, judgment tends to be muddled a bit. So you're not aware of what's going on and you're living in the feel-good moment.
Exactly. And since Justin is the kind of person that will do anything to make sure people are smiling, you know, not saying that he is somebody that's easily taken advantage of, but, you know, due to the circumstances, it seemed like he genuinely cared about people and just wanted to make friends, and he was genuinely having a good time. So when you have things like alcohol involved with that kind of personality, you're already geeked out on the inebriation and the high that comes with acceptance. And unfortunately, you become, you know, very trusting in moments like these. So Justin, feeling like these people genuinely, like, cared about him, obliged their little super easy, like, sway. So they corner him, and one of them says, "Let's chug." What Justin didn't realize, however, was that not only was Dee hiding in the basement, but that they all had knives.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, as Justin put the bottle to his lips, out comes Dee with a knife, who stabbed him so forcefully that her knife went in straight to the hilt.
Over hearsay?
Yeah.
Wow.
Not to mention, this is petty fucking gossip mill that was started because some insecure, overbearing, and jealous asshole, yes, Chad, I'm talking about you, wanted vindication for Justin and his wife briefly seeing each other during a separation. That, an 18-year-old Justin, by the way, still a senior in high school, is a threat to a 42-year-old woman. Yeah, I'm talking to you, Diane Dinkelman, who herself is so childish and insecure that she wants to stab a kid, not even fresh out of high school yet, over some gossip. 42 fucking years old, mad over high school bullshit.
I see why you constantly randomly say I hate people.
I will be clear and say I don't actually hate people. I just hate the shit that they do. I just really honestly wish that we could all just be a bit kinder to each other.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Kindness does go a long way. I think we should take a break here so our listeners can learn about...
Hi, true crime fans. Greg here. Last week, I introduced you to our sponsor, Hunt a Killer. Have you had a chance to check it out? Valentine's Day is right around the corner. What Valentine wouldn't want to catch a killer with you? Don't have a Valentine? Well, you can always treat yourself and your friends with a Galentine's Murder Mystery Party. Hunt a Killer Murder Mystery Subscription Box is one of the most unique games you will ever play. Gwen believes her sister was murdered and must investigate residents she has known her whole life. Gwen needs your help to expose her hometown and uncover the secrets that exist on Mallory Rock. Don't want to subscribe? There are plenty of other one-off mysteries and collections of seasons that need solving. With over 100,000 subscribers and 2,000 five-star reviews, Hunt a Killer will take your true crime obsession to the next level. And if you can't get enough, you can join their spoiler-free community with thousands of members to help you solve difficult puzzles and talk about true crime. Go to huntakiller.com/crime to check out all the options. Use code CRIME at checkout for $10 off your purchase. Part of the proceeds for every box goes to the Cold Case Foundation, an organization that is dedicated to helping with real-life cold cases. That's huntakiller.com/crime, discount code CRIME for $10 off. Thanks to Hunt a Killer for sponsoring True Crime and supporting independent podcasters.
So, prior to the break, you had said that kindness goes a long way.
It does. Just live life by the golden rule, dude. I learned that in elementary school.
It reminded me of a friend of mine, Kevin. He used to constantly say, kindness is timeless and sharing is caring.
Oh, I love that.
Well, continuing on to the story, kindness certainly is timeless, and that's why I really want to highlight Justin Barnard's case.
Because he was a very kind soul, and that his life was ripped from him over senseless acts. And this isn't to scare everybody into thinking they shouldn't be kind. Always be kind. It's the right thing to do. I mean, don't be kind if you're put in a situation where kindness is going to get you killed.
Yeah, no, don't do that.
Like, if a strange man is trying to holler at you. But by all means, if they don't get the hint, then be rude.
Yeah, be rude.
But if you're kind and can also make a good point that people cannot and will not take advantage of you, it truly does go a long way.
Amen to that. So at this point, everyone else joins in. We were talking about how, like, they were about to, you know, or they did just stab Justin. So everyone, you know, joins in. They're wielding their knives and stabbing Justin. There were no defensive wounds, only Justin saying over and over, "Why are you hurting me?" Yeah, that's the part that got me thinking, like, Mama Bear, you know? They then left him to suffer there for hours in the fetal position, putting their cigarettes out on him as well as other forms of torture. And you know, it's easy for me to feel extreme sympathy for a victim in any case of bullying, especially a child, but something about reading this, you know, Justin being so defenseless, it just keeps bringing fucking tears to my eyes, dude. He was minding his own fucking business, and I will never fully understand unnecessary evil in this world, and this was absolutely unnecessary.
This is purely heartbreaking.
Yeah.
It was so defenseless. He didn't even do anything to cause this.
So as he kept asking them why they were hurting him, Stefan took the knife and slit his throat in an effort to silence him.
Oh, wow.
Mm.
What a freaking hero. That's snark, by the way, in case y'all didn't catch that.
No, I don't think anybody caught it.
Nobody caught it because I didn't say it that way.
So Chad decided that now was the time for another cigarette because it's a lot of work and stress to start a rumor, manipulate people, and have those people around you doing your bidding.
Yes, what a wonderful time for a smoke break, Chad.
He also stood there and watched Justin essentially bleed out. Stefan then took two bricks and gave him three blows to Justin's head, finally killing him. And for what?
Yeah, exactly, for what?
And I'm not saying that Stefan did the right thing by any means, but what sucks is that Justin was already suffering at the hands of Stefan and Chad, and you know, Stefan essentially ended the suffering that way. It's like, at least he did that. You know, didn't make him suffer for any longer than he could have, but at the same time, fuck Stefan with a poisonous cactus.
I concur.
Also, on record, I'd like to say that I don't normally use the word pussy to describe someone. My favorites are like shitbag or garbage person or even beef jerky face, but Chad is the epitome of beef jerky maggot infested cat food pussy. I have some not so kind words about the others as well, but Chad, you know, he's the ringleader, and if anyone wants to at me for that, go right ahead, but this is my hill and I will fucking die there.
I concur once again.
So, have you ever watched Squid Games on Netflix?
No, it's really not my thing, but I've heard great things about it. I might watch it sooner or later.
Nate and I totally binged it, and right after we binged that, we ended up watching Alice in Borderland, binged that, and frankly, Squid Games is better just because, you know, Alice in Borderland, it was good. It was almost the same concept, but it was just a little bit too dramatic for me, but...
Oh.
Anyway, but if you have watched Squid Game, there's this gangster dude, and the character was named Doc Sue, and basically Chad is Doc Sue in this.
Ew.
Yeah, yeah. I would at least watch Squid Games just to get that idea. So, around this time, Chad and Stefan hosed Justin's lifeless body down, you know, of all of the blood, where it went down a drain in Dee's basement. They then wrapped his body in a sheet and secured it with weighted fishing rope tied around his neck, waist and legs, and then loaded his body into the back of Dee's pickup truck. And it's important to note here that Dee had a 14-year-old son at the time who was upstairs the entire time all of this shit was happening.
Hold up. Dinkelman had a kid?
Yep. Thankfully, after all this was said and done, he was taken from her by, like, social services or CPS, I believe.
But how could she, as a mother,
yeah,
do this to somebody else's son?
Exactly.
Like, you'd think that, as a mother, you'd be at pause.
Yeah. So, don't worry. To your point, this question does get asked. But remember, Dee is just this weird, childish, and worthless piece of human-walking shit that only cares about her own well-being. And Dee and Stefan then drove to a bridge on Mill Avenue Southeast, which is near Newtown Mall, over in New Philadelphia. And around 3 o'clock a.m. on Tuesday, September 20th, Dee backed up toward the railing, and Stefan then threw Justin's body over the railing into the Tuscarawas River.
Assholes.
And on their way back, a police officer who was en route to respond to an alarm pulled Dee and Stefan over.
Good.
Unfortunately, he let them go with a warning that day because Dee had forgotten to turn her lights on.
Ugh, okay. So basically, they got away with it.
For now. But anyway, they returned to Dee's house. Dee, Stefan, Chad, and Amanda then resumed cleaning up that day. They were busy repainting the basement and cleaning up after, you know, all of that shit that they'd done in an effort to hide any evidence. They then threw out any knives used and the remainder of the weighted rope in different areas of both Dee's neighborhood and in a mobile home park called Shelmar, where Amanda Bowditch had grown up.
Okay, but what a bunch of idiots. That's not how you get rid of evidence. Everyone knows that.
I do not deny that these people weren't the smartest. The next day, Chad and Stefan had a conversation, and Stefan remembered Chad being super giddy about what they had done. And Chad kept asking Stefan who they were going to kill today. And Stefan had said, he'd responded with, "We ain't killing anyone else." And a few days later, Chad, I guess covering his tracks, goes to Justin's mom's house to ask where Justin is.
I'll give Stefan that.
Yeah.
He at least started to show a little remorse.
Yes, but it's believed that he had told someone that he's killed a man and he would do it again.
Okay, well, never mind.
Yeah. So Chad had also told the others that they needed to avoid detection for 7 days and that if they could do this, they would never get caught. So, you know, what a swell, smart guy.
Super smart.
Except science is smarter because a decomposing body produces gas, and gas will bring a body to the surface of water. And it is here where I'm going to bring it back to the discovery that I started with. On September 27th, 2005, at the Tuscarawas River, located near Akron, Ohio and Barberton, Ohio, police discovered a body wrapped in a sheet that was bound in blue weighted rope, snagged on a tree limb. A further discovery revealed a bloated and badly decomposing body and later confirmed it to be that of Justin Barnard.
Oh, please tell me they get caught. Pretty please?
Well, coroners determined that Barnard died from a massive skull fracture and also suffered 16 or 17 stab wounds to the head, neck, trunk, and extremities. 6 of the stab wounds were in the front of his neck and 2 penetrated his voice box. They had said that the skull was intact, but that the blunt force trauma was so evident that Justin was nearly unrecognizable.
How awful. Mm. And what a way to leave this world. So heartbreaking.
It really is. Police start to track this and start questioning anyone who may have been a witness, including the Bowditch family. The police didn't quite realize how hot on their trail they were right away. One of the people interviewed is the person that went to the fair with Justin. The friend who accompanied Justin to the fair had returned to the brown house with him shortly before he was killed, and he would later tell authorities that Chad Bowditch said later that Justin had left in the middle of the night to go to California to see his father.
Which is, of course, a blatant lie.
Yeah, because you're not going to just overnight go from Ohio to California.
No.
It's not going to happen. So at this point, they had no idea of the Bowditch's involvement, but that didn't last for very long because things started to smell really fishy, and I mean old, maggoty, Shelly no-tech cat food kind of fishy.
Taking it way back, I see.
Yep, when I had that potential Shelly no-tech smelling at work.
Ugh, may have just thrown up a little.
Yeah, so they began questioning everyone and noticed many inconsistencies in stories. After several interviews over a period of several days and figured up after one person said they blatantly planned to drop Justin off at Dee's house, the police were then tipped off to Dee, Chad, Stefan, and Amanda. Police said various inconsistencies pointed to the four, but that nobody interviewed blatantly pinned blame on anyone.
Maybe they were scared of these four?
And that is very, very possible because it seemed like they all had somewhat of a manipulative type of, you know, puppeteer personality. And I feel like people would do just about anything to be left the fuck alone by those kind of people.
Yeah, like acted like they ran the neighborhood?
Bingo. They then arrested all four of them with reasonable cause. And for some time, all but Dee were talking. As the three that were cooperating were starting to make confessions, police searched Dee's house and her pickup truck for evidence. A fun fact about cleaning up after a murder is that, Luminol sees it all. So no amount of cleaning up will hide from Luminol. So that's fun.
For those of you who don't know, Luminol, by the way, it's a substance used to pick up blood evidence not seen by the naked eye. Detectives are then able to take the evidence for further testing. If they're able to obtain DNA from the quote-unquote invisible to the naked eye samples, they send and it matches with the victim. So, well, looks awfully suspect.
And I'm no scientist, but, you know, if bleach can make a t-shirt turn white but not burn through it right away, I'm pretty sure that bleach can't burn through every bit of DNA evidence either. No. And also, Luminol can pull blood from a paint coating. That's also fun. The best way I can describe luminol, imagine dyeing your hair like a semi-permanent color, my bad. And, you know, it's something that you can see in a black light. And then so you wash your hair until all the hair dye is gone, but the black light still picks up the hair dye that's washed down the drain, you know, like the yeah. after effect of all that.
Yeah.
Now, instead of hair dye, it's blood, and it shows up under a black light after you apply this substance. Luminol to a surface, and that's just the way I can describe it.
That's a pretty fair comparison.
Yeah. At one point, it suggested that they all practice Wicca and then Satanism. It keeps getting brought up, but it's found to have zero relevance to this case whatsoever. So to those of you coming into this with fresh eyes and ears, if anyone tries to pin blame on spiritualism, note that spiritualism has zero to do with this, and just that's more gossip, so fucking ignore it.
It's interesting to me how religion and spirituality and belief systems and whatnot keep getting brought up in these cases. Why do you think that is?
Well, people have a natural fear of the unknown, and I think that that's why. I mean, if they don't know what it is and they're scared of it, they automatically will point the blame to what they fear. They hear about cases of Satanism, and people without knowing the full details of what Satanism actually is, for example, they'll be like, well, it must be the work of the devil, you know, because they practice Satanism. Remember, yeah. the whole Pazuzu thing? It's like...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so basically the whole point is that you could be a pope, you could be the fucking president.
You could be Mother Teresa. Or Britney Spears, even.
Yes, and you still never know what people are capable of, no matter what they believe.
Can I just take a moment to say something, speaking of Britney Spears?
Yes, go ahead.
Hashtag freed Britney. Heck yes.
I concur. So happy she escaped that conservatorship. But back to the fuckasses, though.
And not the fuckasses that were practically holding Britney hostage. Courtney means back to the case.
Yes, but I am very, very happy for Brit. So, two of the four had confessed to the murder, and the three teens continued to cooperate. And it finally came time for a trial.
Good. Here we go.
Chad Bowditch and Stefan both received sentences of life in prison without parole in May of 2006, and for their parts in Barnard's death.
Yay!
Indeed. Okay. Now, all of this is quoted, and I'll end it in quotes because this came directly from one of my sources above. So, according to Justin's father, Michael Barnard, quote, "In my opinion, he should suffer the same terror and trauma he inflicted upon my son. Amen. I, along with other family members, would volunteer to gang stab him, and as he lay on that filthy basement floor, I would take great pleasure in bashing his head in with a brick until his brains ooze out. But however, since that can't be done, I would settle for answers to the questions, why... Why was Stefan so weak that he could not stand up for his friend? Why didn't his parents do a better job of raising him? If there is any justice, you will die in prison or you will kill yourself," Barnard had continued. "Are you here to offer any kind of apology? If you are, save it. I don't want to hear your lies." So that was the end quote. And Michael Barnard is Justin's father.
Oh.
He called Chad Bowditch, the instigator of all these vile pieces of human shit, and said he'd hopefully be killed while in prison. Now, Justin Barnard's grandmother, LaVanche Barnard, also from California, asked both Stefan and Chad if they still can hear her grandson begging for his life. Gotta love the grandma. Gotta love the grandma. They always have your back. She said she hoped they'd never be able to return to New Philadelphia, a nice city with a calm river containing Justin's blood running through it. End quote.
I hope that to this day, Justin's pleading and asking why is haunting them.
Here's the kicker, though. Dinkelman.
Oh, shit. Dinkelman.
Is serving 21 years to life in the Ohio Reformatory for Women at Marysville. Her first parole hearing will be held in August of 2026.
Excuse me? She was given a chance for parole?
Yep. Dinkelman, 42 at the time, pled guilty in December 2005 to all charges filed against her as part of a negotiated plea agreement because entitlement. She did a crime, but someone forced her hand, as is almost always the case, apparently.
She was the adult here.
Yeah.
Entitled people who cannot take accountability, one of our biggest pet peeves.
Yep. She also ended up cooperating with the prosecution of Amanda Bowditch, who basically didn't even get brought up until just now.
Mm-hmm.
Even though Dinkelman and Chad both are the big problems here.
Oh, Lord.
Justin's mother, are you ready for this?
Mm-hmm.
Had this to say about Dinkelman, quote, "To know that a mother of a teenager killed my son is incomprehensible. Diane Dinkelman bludgeoned my son to death while her son was in the home. She performed repugnant acts on my son in her home, disposed of my son's lifeless body, then continued to live with her son in the home where these acts were committed." And then Justin's father also spoke before the sentence was imposed. He said that his son cared for others very much and probably considered Dinkelman, as well as Dinkelman's son, a friend.
How awful.
Yeah. His dad goes on to say, "Though he was not a saint, he was innocent of anything that would have warranted this murder, let alone the manner in which Dee carried out the murder and the abuse of his corpse." He then turned his attention to Dinkelman, who was dabbing at her eyes with a tissue because, you know, Dee's the real victim here.
Yeah, right.
So as he spoke, he said, "Every time you wake up in that cage, I want you to think of Justin. You will have everything free at the cost of my son's life. Remember to thank him every moment of your miserable existence."
Well, it sounds like Dee has a lot to be thankful for.
Yeah, she is incredibly lucky, because if it had been me, I'd be quickly rushed to a holding cell. I'd probably jump over that stand and try to offer my damn self.
Can't say I blame you.
Justin's dad then closed his comments by asking Dinkelman the question that has been asked over and over. Quote, "Why? If you ever come up with an answer, contact me personally. I want to know." End quote.
And yet, no answers, no closure. Wow.
First off, I do need to remind you all again. 42-year-old woman mad about a potential shit-talking, so she stabs him? Secondly, Chad was the one who started this. Also, I'd like to go on record and state that Dee looks like a fucking toe, and if you imagine seeing her cry in court, I'm imagining a toe that's seeping pus out of the corners of its toenail, because Dee is just this nasty fucking toe, and I hope she hears this and suffers with athlete's foot on her face for all eternity. Dinkelman, she just got away with far too much, but, you know, she's a toe that's apparently getting out soon.
What?
She's a toe. So, according... She's a fucking toe. She looks like a fucking toe.
I'm gonna have to look her up.
Oh. I showed her picture to my mom, because my mom was like, "What is getting you all riled up?" And I was like, "Fucking Dinkelman." And she was like, "I want to see a picture," because my mom, she's cool as fuck, but she's like nosy. So, I show her a picture, and she's like, "She does look like a toe."
Oh, God.
So... Yeah. According to one of my sources, you know, she's getting out.
Hmm.
I hope it's just a rumor, but I doubt it, because Dee seems like the kind of person to know how to work the system. Probably privileged white person manipulation syndrome, but anyway.
Wow. I hate to give her that much credit, but wow.
So Chad entered a plea deal, and prosecutor Amanda K. Spies.
Another Amanda?
Yeah. So that makes, if including you, three whole different Amandas.
We've talked about
three different Justins so far and three Amandas. But anyway, Amanda Spies directed Judge Edward O'Farrell, who, by the way, he retired this year, January of 2021, to sentence Bowditch on the aggravated murder count, which can result in a sentence of life without parole. Under Ohio law, although an offender may plead guilty to multiple charges stemming from the same act, they can only be sentenced on one charge. In cases that contain multiple counts, the prosecutor decides upon which count the sentence will be imposed.
Okay.
So, as the prospective jury was called and the first group was being decided, Paul Hervey, Chad's attorney, decided on a private conversation with prosecutors and O'Farrell. After two private meetings, Chad went ahead and pled guilty, stated by Hervey that they wanted to save his family the heartache of a trial.
Cool, but can we have the avoided the heartache of the Barnard family in the first place?
Right. Amanda Bowditch. She was the last one to get the sentence. Prior to this, she was awaiting a second psych eval after the first one said that she was fit to stand trial. I'm not going to get too thick into it, But I have to say, I do sympathize somewhat to her plight. According to her defense attorney, she was sexually abused a multitude of times. And, I mean, that's also been kind of, like, insinuated by several sources. So, okay. She had developed a borderline personality disorder, which is what you called in the very beginning.
Mm-hmm.
As a result, she was described as someone who was easily manipulated and wanted to please everyone, but also described as someone who faked mental illness to get a lesser sentence.
Well, that's messed up.
So the really fucked up thing is that while abuse of any kind is not okay, and I understand that, quite a bit of issues can occur later in life as a result, but there is still no clear or good reason for her to do what she did.
No. Suffering abuse of any kind doesn't give you a golden ticket or free rein to do what you want to, people. Sorry.
Say it again for the people in the back. There's plenty of people even today who need to hear it.
Suffering abuse of any kind does not give you a golden ticket or free rein to do what you want to people. Hit subscribe and follow me for more tips.
Exactly. Basically, just be kind. You can tell your story to others, but instead of acting out based off of your past, lead by example. Be that person that overcame. Live a great life and lead by example. Don't do what these shitbags did. It was noted that she had wanted to end her own life since as young as 11, but didn't know how. It was noted many times in the court proceedings that these two were friends and that Justin cared about Amanda very much. He gave her friendship when nobody else would, and nobody else was there for her. And you know how she thanked him? By helping to kill him.
It's incredibly sad that suicide is even considered an option to people. But it also feels like she used it as a pity crutch, which unfortunately is a thing. Mm-hmm. It just gets to me that there were actual legitimate friends and yet she participated. Nobody forced her hand. Jesus.
Yeah. Justin's mother really breaks my heart here. I feel like some of what she said would normally be something I would consider a bit too harsh, but honestly, as a mother myself, I do not blame her one single bit. She's noted as telling Amanda that she hopes that she succeeds in killing herself one day. Now, Justin's father, oh man, Justin's father sadly begs her to look into his eyes, his quote-unquote blue eyes, I recall him saying. And I assume that Justin had the same kind of eyes based off of this alone. And he had pleaded with Amanda to remember how much Justin loved her.
Can you imagine your husband saying something like that to someone about Anna since they favor in the eyes?
Or if Ben had to say something like that about Emmett, like...
But it wouldn't happen, because believe me, there's a mama bear living in both of our bodies.
And, you know, that's not to say Justin's parents didn't have that same kind of heart, you know? It's just a really... So, Amanda Bowditch's mother says that she feels bad that she couldn't give Amanda the help she needed. Quote, "I can feel your pain and suffering," she had said halting. "I am very sorry. They lost a son. I'm losing my daughter. She does have a heart. Justin was a kind, loving person, but she loved him as well."
I get that she feels bad for her daughter.
Yeah.
But come on. She isn't losing her kid to the degree that these two lost their son. Mm-hmm. It's not a competition. Come on. Take accountability, people.
It's frustrating. She goes on to say, "It's a nightmare we can't wake up from either. We are suffering as well. She's my little girl. I love her as any mother would love her child. I never turn my back on her, and I never, ever will turn my back on her."
Oh, come on.
"I can't say, though, that if my daughter was guilty of being part of a murder, that I would not have the same kind of sentiment. Because, truthfully, I don't know how I would act in that situation. But I will be letting Anna know as soon as she's old enough to understand that murdering people is never the answer unless she's literally in a situation for self-defense."
Sure.
And finally, Amanda herself expresses some remorse for what she had done by saying, quote, "I can't give you your son back. I'm very sorry for what I've done. I know there are times he cared for me and loved me. I don't know why we did what we did."
Well, at least she recognizes that she was wrong for her part in this, but still.
I can certainly, you know, empathize with the statement that Justin's mother made about wishing Amanda would kill herself, but I also don't wish that on her. I do hope that she lives out the rest of her life remembering what she did to her friend who cared very much about her. I hope it haunts her for the rest of her life and how she played a huge role in his murder. I don't excuse the fact that Amanda is a victim of abuse, but I do hope that judgment hits her square in the face and that karma does its job.
Hear, hear.
Justin's mom is quoted as saying at one point, "How do you deal with something like this? It's not something you're programmed to do. It's like the world did a flip and it's not back on its axis yet."
She's right.
Yeah.
As mothers, we're programmed to defend our children to the utmost degree.
Yeah.
We aren't exactly meant to be programmed to deal with mourning the loss. It's not something you just deal with.
I've said it once and I'll say it again. If something ever happened to my own daughter, I'd be right there with her, wherever she is. If it means that she's in a grave, guess what? I'd be there too. That's how I would just quote-unquote deal with that. So, Justin Barnard is remembered in New Philadelphia to this day by his friends and family. I can't overemphasize enough the impact that he has had on a town and his group of friends. Justin was unfortunately a victim of a senseless murder, only falling prey to an insecure and overly jealous douchebag and his posse of equally disgusting douchebags. His memory is placed forever in photos of a heart-shaped Lego memorial placed on the walls of Park Place Teen Center, which is now unfortunately closed down.
In the show notes, we will include a link to the Facebook page Remembering Park Place Teen Center. Please, if you're able to do so, go to that page and let's start a hashtag, Remembering Justin Barnard. Let's make it go viral. Let's make it go to where we post his picture and use the hashtag.
Yeah, let's make that go viral because he deserves that kind of exposure. If he had been allowed to live, I am very certain that Justin would be making an impact on the entire world today, advocating for misfits, abuse victims, and the less fortunate. It's up to us to keep his memory alive, as very much like April Tinsley, he too almost went forgotten. I've had the utmost pleasure of getting to know Justin through the memories of his close friends and extensive research, and I too am very heartbroken by this loss. But my intent is to reach people as much as I feel he would have, and let those who are less fortunate, misfits, and abuse victims know that we are in your corner, and we are advocating heavily for you, as I'm sure Justin would have.
I do have an ending quote.
Yeah.
Lately, we've been joking around and using actual song lyrics where Courtney will jokingly guess the wrong person. But today, I'd like to end this with this quote. "For me, I am driven by two main philosophies. Know more today about the world than I knew yesterday and lessen the suffering of others. You'd be surprised how far that gets you." Neil deGrasse Tyson.
I have one too. I don't know who said this one, but the quote is, "You never look good trying to make someone else look bad."
Spot on.
With this, I would like to share a memory from one of... Fuck. Okay, sorry. I'm like a little bit... Okay. I would like to share a memory from one of his very close friends, Christina, who is one of the sources mentioned above. But before that, I'd like to say, from Amanda and I, to Justin Barnard's family and friends, we are so terribly sorry for your loss and only hope and pray that Justin's memory be fired up and rekindled. He seemed like such a beautiful soul, and we would have welcomed him into our inner circle with open arms. We applaud you all and the strength you all have had in his memory, and I can assure you that he's smiling down on you all. So happy to be at peace and feeling loved and accepted by all who have surrounded him in life and in memory. And Justin, you are loved, remembered, and missed, and you have impacted people for the better, whether you've known that in your life or not. Thank you for your servant's heart and purest of soul. May you forever rest in peace, knowing you did good in this world. And in the spirit of Thanksgiving, here's a clip from Christina Daniels, remembering Justin and what she was thankful for.
So excuse if you can hear my voice cracking or anything. This is just kind of emotional. But, Justin, my favorite thing that we ever did together was you invited me over to watch a movie, and you let me pick the movie, and it was Jurassic Park 3, and it was my favorite Jurassic Park, and so that's why you didn't have a problem watching it, even though it's kind of the crappiest one. But you held my hand while we watched the movie, and so that was cute. And you still wanted to hang out after the movie was over, and so you said, "Do you want to walk to the mall and just walk around?" And it was a little bit chilly outside, and I did not have a jacket or a coat or a hoodie or anything. And so you gave me a black sweatshirt, just a plain black sweatshirt, not a hoodie, just a sweatshirt. And then you said I could keep it. and I kept it for years. And I don't know what happened to that sweatshirt. This is where I'm starting to cry. But I really wish that I had it now. Even back then, I was very upset that I lost it, but it was my own personal piece of you, so I'm just sad that I don't have that anymore. But I've got the memory with it, so that's what I'm keeping from that. And I just want to let you know that I'm very thankful that I got to meet you and spend time with you and get to know your goofy ass, because everybody that knew you definitely knew that you were a goofball. Even my mother and my younger sister. The very first thing that my mother and sister said about you after you left my house one day was, "Oh God, he's tall." So you're very well remembered by anybody who ever had the pleasure of meeting you. And just know that you're missed and loved. So, yeah. Love you, buddy.
Make sure you follow us on all of the things. We'll include it in the show notes, but just hit up linktr.ee/a nefarious nightmare podcast, and you will find all of our things there.
We do have a website.
Yeah.
It will be up and running soon.
Hopefully.
A nefariousnightmare.com, where you can just find all of it lumped together.
And don't bully people, y'all.
And don't start rumors.
And to everyone else, don't be a dick.
And wear deodorant.
Rest in peace, Justin Derik Barnard.
Thank you so much for listening to A Nefarious Nightmare. Music used in this podcast is by Ghost Stories Incorporated. You can find all their music on bandcamp.com.
Additional music used in this episode is composed by Mattia Cupelli. You can find his music on YouTube.
You can find all links to our social media and merch store on linktr.ee/a nefarious nightmare podcast.
Thank you so much for listening.
And take care.
Thanks again for listening to True Crime by Indie Drop-In. If you would like your show featured, reach out to us at Indie Drop-In on all social media or go to indiedropin.com. See you next time.